Now let's talk about James Gandolfini and
Jimmy. Yeah.
He left us. How long ago did he leave us?
2013.
3 years ago.
Yeah.
Talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, the phone call was devastating. Michael called me, Imperioli. Mm-hmm. He was in California, and he said, "We lost Jimmy." I said, "Yeah, I heard." And
so how did you got the phone call, but how did you first hear?
Tony Darrow called me, who's on the Sopranos, and I didn't believe him. And he got mad at me. He said, "Why would I make something like this up?" And then Michael called me from L.A., and the next thing you know, we're all at this church in Harlem, and there was 2,500 people there.
Yeah,
2,500. I mean, you had major stars, and you had a lot of people, a lot of fans, and it was amazing. It was like, you know, putting the Pope to sleep.
And here's what happens: that, like, through no fault of anybody, but you know, with a show like The Sopranos that was on for so long, it was so big. Yeah. We see James Gandolfini as Tony Soprano,
yeah,
right? And that's just what happens. But, you know, away from the camera, yeah, completely 180
opposite.
Yeah,
a whole other body of work.
Now, not even the work, just the man himself.
Yeah, what he did with the Wounded Warriors.
Yeah.
He went to Iraq with Tony Sirico twice.
Mm-hmm.
He produced a lot of stuff. He was a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful actor. But what happens is that we go on in life, you know, after we're gone, and we have this, they give you this image, and that's,
right,
you know, like, Telly Savalas will always be Kojak, and Peter Falk will always
be Columbo.
The iconic
Tony
role.
Soprano. Yeah, Jimmy Gandolfini will always be Tony Soprano, and yours truly will always be Big Pussy. What the hell are you going to do about it?
Yeah. Nothing at all. I mean, yeah, I'm going to support you
in every endeavor.
That's what it is.
He was very generous, I read, to the people just on the cast, right?
Let me tell you a story. He gets a raise. All of a sudden, the main guys, there's about eight of us, the main people, they all got a check for $20,000 from Jimmy's production company.
Wow.
Why did he gave us all $20,000, about 10 people. Why did he do that? Because that's Jimmy,
see?
You know? And when he got a raise 1 year and the other guys weren't getting raises, he says, "I'm not going back to work until everybody else gets a raise."
I remember that.
He wouldn't go back to work. So that was Jimmy. That was Jimmy. Yeah. And one of the things I loved about working with Jimmy is that, you know, when you're doing television, they give you one take, two take, and they said, boom, that's it, let's move on. And Jimmy say, "Are you happy? You like what you did? You sure? You want to move on?" He had that much control. "You want to move? Vinny, how do you feel?" And the day the Emmys came out, he called me up in the morning about 7 o'clock in the morning after they announced the Emmys, and he said, "Vinny, it's Jimmy. You got robbed." He wanted me to get nominated. Mm-hmm. You know, I love the guy. I miss him a lot.
Let me ask, when you were filming the show, when did you find out? Because you were a fixture of the main crew, you and Paulie and Tony and everybody else on there. When did you crack open the script for the first time and realize, I'm getting whacked?
Well, between the first season and the second season, when we went a break, David Chase called me up and he said, because my character took off, you know, he couldn't find the guy.
Yeah.
He said, "There's a lot of interest on the internet about where's Pussy." So he says, "This is what we're going to do." Because they didn't even write the second season yet. They had a, you know, treatment, but they didn't write it. He says, "You're going to carry it. You're going to be the main guy. It's going to be you, but you're going to get killed." Mm. So I never knew what episode I was going to get killed in, you know? So every time I get a script, I said, "Am I going to get killed this week?" I would look at it, and he let me, I got killed in the last episode. So at least I got a year out of that one.
Was it heartbreaking? Did you want to see that character continue on?
Yeah,
were you happy with the arc? Well, I mean, obviously, the paycheck
You know what I say to people, and this is true. What I was able to achieve in those 2 years, maybe I couldn't have done that if I stayed on for 4 or 5. I think the character was stronger because of what happened. Nobody ever thought that in television history, a main guy was going to get killed. They thought they were going to put me in witness protection or something. So that impact, I think, helped create my journey after that. Because when I was done with that show, I went to Hollywood, and I was working like crazy.
Yeah.
You know?
Mike Anderson, what's up?
Well, I'm wondering, Vincent, I was watching the scene a minute ago. What's it like filming a death scene like that with the guns blazing? You got squibs popping on your chest.
Yeah.
What's that feel like? I mean,
you know, it's something, you know, it's like a question you would ask me in my acting workshop.
That, yeah, that's exactly.
You know, right. Professor,
that's a perfect question.
Mike's an artist. That's,
you know,
why.
How do you see? How do you? What do you do? What do you? You actually have to feel like you're going, like you're dying. You got to feel that. You know,
I mean, the look on
you
got
to feel like you got shot. You got to feel like it's your moment. It's that's. You have to believe that's happening to you.
Wow.
Otherwise, it's not going to work.
In a show that I love that started good and fell off, there was a character on that show, Sons of Anarchy, a guy named Opie, big bearded dude.
You didn't like that? My boy Chuck Zito was on.
Started great, yeah. Ended whatever. But the reason I bring it up is that there was a pretty heavy-duty death scene in that where they hit play, they've recorded the whole thing, cut, everyone's crying off set. People are busted up because they know their friend is now done with the show.
Well, so that's what happened with me.
I was going to ask, what was the crew's reaction knowing they're not going to see their buddy Vincent around
cut,
anymore?
Yeah,
well, Jimmy and Little Steven was upset. And Little Steven and I became very close. His wife and I have a theater company in New York, and I always work with Little Steven. Little Steven was upset, but Tony Sirico, who I knew before that, he was actually fighting with one of the producers. Why you got to do this to the guy? Why are we getting rid of him? This is stuff. You know, I know it's television, but the guy needs a paycheck. Everybody was upset. They were upset. And Jimmy, and they came over and they gave me, I get this thing at home. It was a humidor. Mm-hmm. And Jimmy came over and he put this humidor. I'm laying on the ground, you know, because I don't want to move, you know, for the next take with the squibs coming up. And he put this thing on my chest. It was a humidor. And inside were all these great cigars. And it was the humidor on the, there was a thing. From all of us, you know, a little thing, it was an experience, yes.